Father Arsenie Boca, a man of God. All the diamonds in the world are nothing compared to a moment in God's light. Father Arsenie Boca. Prislop Monastery, in the area of Hartzeg. A grave covered in flowers that are said to keep fresh forever. A site of pilgrimage for thousands of people. The final resting place of Father Arsenie Boca. On the 28th of November, 2009, 20 years after he passed away, 30,000 people participated in the commemorative mass. This yet uncanonized saint of Romanian Orthodoxy is still revered and loved by many, much as he himself loved many during his life. He lived in the spirit of humbleness and of God's saving grace, the life of a man like no other. He was a magnet to believers in all walks of life, but also a target of permanent suspicion by the state authorities. State officials failed to understand the source of his exceptional power of making people listen and follow. He stood in faith for his people's redemption, for the people he was chosen from. God has a plan for redemption. It is a masterpiece of grace. It is the masterpiece of our eternal Father. We are all part of this plan, each one with our little individual plans. We cannot know his plan, for our nature is dark and fallen. And yet, we can be led if we allow it, if we listen. This is the voice of Father Arsenie. It is a call to fulfill our vocation, which is our soul salvation. I can only say this, for all those to whom he was good enough to reveal himself, as he revealed himself to me, he was a reflection of our Savior Jesus Christ. He made Christ transparent to us through his ways. Father Arsenie Boca was born on the 29th of September 1910 in the village Vata de Sus in the Apuseni Mountains. His parents, Josef and Cristina, named him Zian Volean, an unusual name. Zian seems to be a local form of Yuan. It is probably derived from Sun Zian. His father was a cobbler, and Zian remembered he was a good teacher. Once he even gave him a beating for idling his time away. The child cried and promised it would never happen again. And this promise would guide him his entire life like a guardian angel. The Boca family lived in Bujoara, a hilly neighborhood in Vata de Sus. Zian's childhood unfolds among trees and flowers. Up on a hill, even the presence of other children was a rarity. Perhaps that explains why Father Boca loved silence so much. His primary school and high school are in Brad, the cultural and economic heart of Zarand country. His adolescence is troubled by two difficult moments, his parents' divorce and his father's early death at just 45. Zian Boca graduates first in his high school class. To celebrate, he plants an oak tree in the courtyard of his school. Zian's oak still grows there. With an inclination for hard sciences, he would have liked to study aviation in Bucharest. Poverty thwarted his plans. he enrolls instead in the Theological Seminary of Sibiu, which back then offered scholarships for poor students. Zian Boca is an avid reader of psychology and philosophy, attempting to penetrate the secrets of the soul. His passion for hard sciences will remain with him throughout life. He speaks French and German. He plays the flute and loves painting. He is nicknamed the Saint by his seminary colleagues, as even then he was remarkable in his ascetic life and intense religious feelings. The Archbishop of Ardèle, Nicolai Bolan, finds out about his talent for painting and gives him a scholarship to study at the Fine Arts Academy in Bucharest. He lives in the dormitory of the Theological Seminary at the Radu Voda Monastery and spends his days painting in the workshops on Calea Grivice. His main teachers are Francisc Sirato, Costin Petrescu, and Francisc Reiner, the latter a professor at the medical school. He is an enthusiastic student in Nikifor Krajnik's classes of mystic theology. Supervised by Costin Petrescu, who was painting the fresco of the Romanian Athenaeum, Zian Boca paints King Michael the Great riding into Alba Iulia. Once he graduates from the Fine Arts Academy, he interns for a year at St. Dimitrie Church in Bicsad, Covasna. He paints the church's fresco together with Professor Costin Petrescu. In the fall of 1936, Zian Boca is ordained as deacon under the Archdiocese of Sibiu. A photo shows him in Sibiu, next to Nicolae, Archbishop of Ardèle, at the John the Baptist's Mass. In March 1939, Archbishop Nicolai Bolan sends Deacon Zian to the holy Mount Athos to learn the ways of its monks, to study the paintings and books in the Holy Virgin's garden. In those days, it was quite a privilege to visit Mount Athos, and the young theologian takes full advantage of this period. He copies the old father's writs and researches the manuscripts at the Romanian hermit's cell, Prodromu. He travels to the great monasteries on Athos and to the Romanian hermit cells. Years later, Father Arsenie would say, "When I kissed the hand of John the Baptist, I understood my destiny." It is said that on Mount Athos, Zian Boca prayed to the Mother of God with tears in his eyes to meet the right Father Confessor that would initiate him into the mystery of confession. After a while, the Virgin Mary came to him and took him to a peak where she entrusted him to a confessor that had lived 2 centuries before. Father Boca received from him, through the Holy Spirit, the gift of foresight. He returns to Romania on the 8th of June 1939, and in the fall of the same year goes to Chisinev to study the art of gold gilding and other painting techniques with the Russian painters. Hard times are coming. The Second World War had started, And 1940 was going to be a tragic year in Romanian history. In just a few months, Bessarabia, northern Bukovina, and Herzegovina County are occupied by the Soviet Union Army. Southern Dobrogea is surrendered to Bulgaria, and half of Transylvania goes to Hungary. At the time, Father Arsenia is in Chișinev trying to leave on the last refugee train. From the platform, he watched the Bessarabian poor flee from the Soviet army. Out of the blue, next to him, stood a man in shabby clothes, watching the people with a face wrought with more grief and pain than Father Arsenia had ever seen on a man. Greatly moved, he leaned over to take his bread out of his bag and give it to the man. When he stood up again, the man had miraculously disappeared. He called him the man of grief and remained forever convinced that the man was Jesus himself. Romania soon entered the war. The future was hard to predict. In such difficult times, people looked more and more to God. Archbishop Nicolae Bolan, who hoped in a revival of monkhood, sends young Zian Boca to the monastery at Sâmbătă de Sus, built by Constantin Brâncoveanu and recently restored. On the Friday of the Healing Spring Ceremony, after Easter 1940, in a moving ceremony, Deacon Zian Boca is ordained a monk and receives the name Arsenie.
Why did people come looking for him? People brought their needs and troubles to him. He gave them advice, told them what to do. If their illness was cured, when they came to thank him a month or two later, they'd bring along another 10 or 20 people in their village, people who had their own needs and wanted advice. Soon enough, he was so sought after that the archbishop couldn't understand why the courtyard was always full. Once in the 40s, he asked the monks, "What's with all these people here?" "They're here for Arsenie Boca. He sends them to us for confession." "Well then, let's ordain him a priest. Then he can take confessions." Once he was ordained a priest after the Healing Spring celebration. From Easter till late in the fall, whenever you could sleep outdoors on a blanket, there were never less than 800 to 1,000 people in the monastery courtyard. It was during the war. There were hardships, especially material ones. When we got to Sâmbătă, it was so peaceful and enriching to see Father Arsenie surrounded by people, like a shepherd with his flock. I was impressed with him and remained so for life. Especially as he was dressed in the white coat with a beautiful belt and his hair cut short at the back, not in a ponytail like some monks wear it today. He had great posture and eyes that could see right through you. He looked like a holy man in the army of God's servants. It was enough to see him, to feel touched by him. His eyes were quick and bright. You couldn't turn away from his eyes. His every word was gospel-like. You listened and had to follow.
Trebuia să reții și să urmezi sfatului.
Am auzit o voce.
I heard a voice next to me, foarte, very warm,
foarte,
concerned.
Foarte îngrijorată cumva.
So what happened? I turned, and right before me, just there, was Father Arsenie, a thin white figure dressed in white, a face of angelic beauty, with deep, serious eyes. Why was I frightened? They were just eyes, the blue eyes of a mortal. But that look was, it was endless, no end to it, nothing beyond, infinite depth. I felt that an infinite blue sky was gazing at me through two human eyes. At Simbata Monastery, there is a priest of Christ-like beauty and God-like grace. The news spreads fast in Fogarash and beyond. Hundreds, thousands of people make the pilgrimage. After his ordination, Father Arsenie Boca starts the Simbata movement of spiritual redemption. During the summer, the faithful remain for 2-3 weeks at a time, helping with the chores. They help build the altar in the forest, dam the lakes, the abbey's garden, with the clover, the ornamental pots and stones. All done under the guidance of Father Arsenie. His love for beauty and harmony turned the monastery at the foot of the mountain into a piece of heaven. Father Arsenie also organized spiritual camps for students and intellectuals, to whom he preaches out of his fundamental book, The Path of the Kingdom.
At some point, someone told the father he should ask someone to gather the hay for the monastery somewhere. Father Arsenie only said, "Guys, can anyone?" That's how he talked to everyone. He made you feel comfortable. Can anyone come to collect the hay? And everyone went, with Father Arsenie leading. I didn't go. I was doing something else. But I loved the image of the crowd accompanying the priest. He in his white coat leading that gaudy crowd. Tens of people who went with him. I don't know what they did there, but I remember that image.
În amintire.
Oare preotul ăsta, călugărul ăsta, nu e un impostor?
This monk, is he an impostor or what?
Când îl văd,
these young chicks, when they see this man so handsome, do they abuse this beauty, this gift to build up this awe? This young people fall in love.
Se prevalează,
in all honesty, I prayed to be helped to see, is he an impostor or not? That was the idea.
De admirație și de tineri să îndrăgostesc. Și cu toată sinceritatea, am făcut o rugăciune. Să fiu ajutat să văd, este un impostor sau nu. Ăsta era gândul. Și
suddenly, I see Father Arsenie pausing.
Arsenie oprindu-se și le face semn.
I can't, acum, not now, later.
Nu
I have something to do.
Mai târziu, am o treabă.
And suddenly, he comes towards me. The bishop was there, Archbishop Balan. When he came, that's where he came. So I stepped aside. I was leaning against an apple tree. I stepped aside, but he came right at me. He puts his arm around my shoulder and, seeing me for the first time, says, "Well, Dan, am I an impostor or not?"
Sunt un impostor sau nu?
I was shaken. I said, Father, please forgive me.
He kept the light to one side to light up the path so we could see our way. It was the path of the guest quarters, a rather long way. I kept my eyes on the light, thinking, it's going to be blown out any second now. But no, the wind lifted the light above the candle. Then it fell right back on top of it, still on. Or it flew to the side of the candle, then came right back. And the light never went out. I was awestruck. We were all awestruck, even those used to Sâmbătă Monastery. Father Arsenie gives me the candle and says, you hold the candle and stop wondering so. I took the candle and guided it with both hands so it wouldn't be blown out. But it got blown out right away. Right away. No way could it have burned in that wind. And he says, you don't know how to carry a light in a storm. You have to learn. And I had no idea what he meant. He meant the storms we all have to go through, and we have to learn how to carry the light right through.
We were all working in the garden of the monastery, waiting for our turn for confession. A man from a nearby village brought his 16-year-old daughter to him. She had cerebral palsy. Father Arsenie told him, go home, do your work, leave the girl here. He put her in a monastery cell where an old man cared for her. He gave her water to wash, then got her up carefully when the Mass was over, because the Mass was held at night, according to custom. He put her in a wheelbarrow, put some clothes there, and wheeled her into the courtyard where we did our work, so she could see the women there and talk, so she wouldn't get bored. At noon, he took her back to the cell and fed her. In the afternoon, he took her out again. One day, around 10, I see the girl's wheelbarrow is gone. We all wondered where she was. We saw the monk carrying her in his arms into the church. She couldn't take a step on her own. An hour later, she comes out walking on her own, holding Father Arsenie's arm.
In Sâmbătă, I witnessed one of the most wonderful Passion Sundays that Father Arsenie ever held. Nature helped too. He held the Mass outside, in a sort of round tent. Inside was the altar. We were gathered all around and into the woods nearby. For Passion Sunday and Easter, there were loads of people there, thousands of people. Farther than the eye could see. Imagine a sunny, blessed end of April with God bless nature all around. The seminary students sang. The birds sang in the trees. The priests sang at the altar. I can't describe it. Nature, priests, pilgrims, all raised their voices in prayer to the Heavenly Father. He had a vibrating voice. You could feel the vibrations in your chest. At times he would tear up and lower his voice a little, and all the congregation shedded tears.
This movement at Sâmbătă was singular in the Orthodox Church. First, there was the Holy Mass. I'd never heard such Masses before and never since. Not with any priest, not with anyone else in the country. He started taking confessions in 1942. And at first he was very strict. People came who suffered or went to confession just like that. Since in these villages, confession was more like a formality. 2-3 words, the priest absolved them, and that's that. Father Arsenius saw what he was dealing with and realized that if we remained at that stage where we were then there would be no evolution, no progress in their lives. So his confession took 2, 3, 4, even 5 hours. People were shocked. That was at first. Then they saw that for him, you had to come prepared, especially if you came for a second or third time. Confessions took less time, half an hour maybe, an hour, but not 4 or 5 hours like in the beginning. People were surprised by what he told them. They weren't even aware that many of their deeds were in fact sins. They were just deeds. They were not good or bad. He always took his time, always let you finish. And then he asked, "Why don't you mention this? Why don't you say anything? You did that too." And then you realized you either forgot or did not want to say it. That shows he could understand people's thinking too.
During the war, many women came to him, worried about their husbands who had gone to war. Father Arsenije didn't have time to listen. He just pointed fingers in the crowd and said, "You raise a cross behind the house. You get the food ready. Your husband is injured, but alive." And so on. When the letters came from the front line, they saw everything he said was true. He asked me just 2 questions, one about my father, asking me to tell him to come to him, which I didn't. And I realized it later. I thought my father wouldn't go. I knew my father. He believed Father Arsenije was developing his own religious cult.
Că părintele Arsenie își face un cult al personalității, deci...
So I thought, why would my father go? In fact, I was taking upon myself an opportunity for my father to get redemption, and I hadn't even realized it. So he asked me a question about him and told me to ask him to come to him. The second was about my wish to join a convent when I graduated. Father Arsenije asked me, "How certain are you that you want to take this step?" I said, 99%. He asked, "What about the 1%? I'm afraid this might not be God's calling. I'm afraid that's not what God wants from me. And I'm just boastful of something that's not rightfully mine." Father Arsenije smiled, thought a little, and said, "Child, this 1% of doubt is worth all the 99% of certainty." I went to Brâncoveanu Monastery in Sâmbătă de Sus, and I said shyly,
the way you are when you're young, since I was 16 at the time. Father, I want to go to confession. I want you to hear my confession. Okay, he said. When I start taking confessions, I will hear yours too. He talked to me like he was an old, wise man, talking to his spiritual son. I waited for some years. I went to the monastery often, and I needed religious guidance, but also spiritual guidance in matters of life. I was born in the countryside, not well educated, and I had some notion of faith, but I was a long way from maturity. Years later, my village was about 20 miles from the monastery. I went there in 1948, convinced he would hear my confession. He did. I went in shyly, as you go into confession, but even more so, because I knew I was confessing to a saint. That's how I saw him, how most people did. When he saw me come in so shyly, as I had to be, and was, he smiled and said, "Come to confession, my brother."
M-a văzut și a zâmbit și vino, frate, vino cu aia la spovedanie.
He looked at me and said, "I will first give you a piece of advice for life." And he told me the sentence that many girls in prison learned from me. It was meant for prison, but I didn't know it then. It went like this. Whosoever wants to make his cross lighter merely adds to it. And he said several times, "God help you, child. God help you. God help you." Every time he blessed me, I felt it on the top of my head, and I thanked him deeply. I got up, and Leonida saw me off. There was a bus to Voila. She saw me to the bus and said, "Did you count how many times he blessed you?" "Was I supposed to?" I said. "I didn't count. I didn't know I was supposed to." He says, "It's unusual for a priest to give so many blessings." You couldn't see him kneeling there, but I saw his face. It was incredibly sad. "You have hard times ahead. I'm sorry, I have to say that. But it's better to be forewarned. When you hit the rocks, remember Father Arsenie's blessing." From Mount Athos, Father Arsenie Boca and Father Serafim Popescu brought manuscripts of the Philokalia, which Father Dumitru Staniloae translated. Father Arsenie designed the cover and made sure that the congregation subscribed in large numbers so that the books could be printed and circulated. Father Staniloae gratefully named him Founding Father of the Romanian Philokalia.
The first words that writer Lucian Blaga said when he first met Father Arsenie were these: "Father Arsenie, you are blessed to have become a myth." Father Arsenie asked, "Why is that?" Lucian Blaga replied, "Because you believe what you say." And Father Arsenie said, "Sir, I do not want to wear this hat, that of a living myth." The poet answered, "You will wear it. Our nation needs it."
Next to the thousands of faithful people eager to meet a prophet strong in word and deed, Brâncoveanu Monastery is also visited by political figures and personalities of Romanian culture. On the day of Pentecost in 1942, Marshal Ion Antonescu came with his wife, Maria. King Michael and Princess Ileana, sister of King Carol II, also visited the monastery established by Brâncoveanu. Impressed with Father Arsenie, Princess Ileana invited him to Bran Castle, where he delivered religious sermons and interpreted sections of the Bible. When she left Romania, Princess Ileana wrote Father Arsenie a letter, acknowledging that he had been a guiding light. A lover of solitude, Father Arsenie starts to dig a stone cell on the Sâmbătă Valley at an altitude of 5,500 feet. This catches the eye of the Secret Service that requests informative reports on Father Arsenie. Unjustly suspecting that he might harbor a Legion member hostile to the current regime of Marshal Ion Antonescu. The same unfounded suspicion is raised by the new communist regime and will trail him all through his life. He is repeatedly arrested and interrogated, although politics remain foreign to the monk at Sâmbătă. His meetings and discussions with various Legion members were only conducted as a confessor and believer. Moreover, he urges Legion members to forsake the use of force and guns, as they can be turned against them. In those times, openly spreading Christ's word was a risk that Father Arsenie took on. He never names the communists, but preaches against the godless ones. This unsettles the authorities. In order to avoid another arrest, Archbishop Nicolae Bolan decides to transfer Father Arsenie to a more remote monastery where he could not be so easily reached. Thus ends Father Arsenie's time at Brâncoveanu, the monastery that he loved so much, where he had become spiritually whole and had shepherded so many souls. On the 25th of November 1948, he arrives at Prislop Monastery in the Prislop area. Greek Catholic monks, also driven away by the communists, let the monastery go to ruin. At first, it was a monk's monastery, but soon it switches to nuns. Giulietta Constantinescu, a theology graduate, ordained a nun under the name Zamfira, is appointed the abbess. Father Arsenie remains at Prislop as confessor. A lot of people still come to see him, and the Secret Service's red flag him again. On the 16th of January 1951, at 5 a.m., 10 Secret Service agents brutally enter the monastery and arrest Father Arsenie. There is no trial. He is sent straight to the labor camp at the Danube, Black Sea Canal, where he remains for a year. Released in April 1952, he returns to Prislop. But the persecutions do not cease. He is again arrested and interrogated in Timișoara, Jilava, and Oradea.
I was studying for my A-levels. I had taken the written exam, I was preparing for the oral exam. The day the exam started, we were arrested. They didn't take us upstairs, just led us straight to the common cell. When we came in, we were in front of a camp hospital. At least, that's what I thought it was. There were people who I thought were ill. In fact, they were just sick and gaunt because of all the suffering. I saw a barefoot man with his trousers rolled up to his knees, who was actually a monk. He stood up and asked us, "Who are you? We're students. Where from?" Radu Negru High School, Făgăraș. He looked us up and down. He must have seen the very young ones. Who knows what he thought? And he said, as if to himself, but we heard, "Heaven must still be missing some angels."
Legiunea îngerilor din cer încă nu-i completă. Și însăși faptul că era cu noi era un lucru extraordinar.
Even him being with us was extraordinary. We realized that our suffering was not just our own. It was a collective hurt. Father Arseni in Făgăraș and Southern Ardeal was probably the biggest personality of those days. If he was with us, then we must be somebody too, to have gone to jail next to him.
Însemna că, într-adevăr, și noi suntem cineva dacă am ajuns în pușcărie alături de el.
Fiind la Timișoara, acolo...
In Timișoara, I saw Father Arseni in the flesh. It was a very interesting encounter.
Părintele Arseni, într-un mod deosebit de interesant.
The door opened and the guard barked at me to get my bedpan and go to the washing. I was surprised and I said, "But I just did." The guard snapped at me again, "Get your bedpan and go to the washer." I had to listen. So I took it and I went. The washer was at the end of a corridor, along which were the cells. During regular hours, the cell windows were closed. You could see nothing outside. Now, the windows were open wide. What could be more wonderful for an inmate than to look at the sky and breathe the air through an open window? So I forgot why I was there and rushed to the window. I saw a wonderful landscape, the sky above, though it was barren on the ground. The yard that I saw was where the inmates took their walk. Right there, in the middle of the yard, was Father Arseni Boca, taking his walk.
Am cunoscut, ca preot, un ofițer în rezervă, cu care ne-am și împrietenit, cu familiile.
When I was a priest, I met a retired officer. We became family friends. I can tell you the name, Botezan Petru, in Mureș.
Nu știu dacă nu ăsta a fost părintele.
There was a priest in prison there. It may have been Father Arseni. At some point, the priest says to those in his cell, "Here is what happened in your home." And a week or two later, the man would get a letter, and that thing had indeed happened. When we saw that the priest knew those things, a mate of mine and I asked him, "If you're such a believer, tell us something to get us to believe in God." "No point in me telling you to believe in God, you won't. If you tell us something true, we'll start believing." "Really? Okay then, I'll tell you. Go to the prison gate. There are two women standing there now. One is holding a basket with bacon and bread and so on. And she's carrying a bag with this and that inside. We were curious and went out. We passed the first gate and then the second. At the second gate, the women were right there in front of the gate. We wanted to make sure the priest was right, so we started asking, 'What are you doing here? It's forbidden to stand at the gate. What do you have in there? We have food and stuff. Show us.' And it was all true.
ce aveți acolo, ce aveți? Da, dar ce avem? Uite, avem aici și noi mâncare, așa, așa. Să vedem.
They went to the prison commander and reported, there's an inmate in a cell. I think he's a priest. He can see through walls.
Domnul comandant, uitați, în celula cu tare, avem deținutul cu tare, care cred că e preot, care vede prin zidul închisorii.
When I was a priest at Prislop, I remember an elderly man from Cimmeria came to me and told me, very moved, that back in prison, Father Arseni was praying in the cell where he was an inmate. And the guard told people how Father Arseni was wrapped in flames while praying. And he levitated above the ground like St. Mary the Egyptian did, seen by Ava Zosima. Like Ava Arseni from Paterix did, also wrapped in flames during prayer, seen by his disciple through the window of his cell in Egypt.
Released by the secret services after another 6 months, Father Arsenie returns to Prislop, but will eventually be driven away because of communist pressure. In May 1959, a decision of the Bishop of Arad forbids him to wear the monk's cloth and serve as a priest. Seen as Ardèle's greatest preacher, Father Arsenie Boca is now silenced. Prislop Monastery is closed down and the nuns are forced to return to the world. Shortly after, the monastery is turned into a home for the elderly. Father Arsenie goes to Bucharest, but his surveillance only increases, as shown in the 1,200-some pages of his operational surveillance file. He is now wearing civilian clothes, as elegantly as he wore the monk's outfit. It is difficult to imagine that this elegant man, in a suit and sunglasses, is the father confessor from Sumbata. He leads a quiet life, sometimes going out to see a movie, or eat an ice cream, or go trekking in the Buchej. At least 10 informants are spying on him, some of them trained and brought over from other towns. Sadly, some of them are men of cloth. We can imagine the father Arsenie easily spotted them, which even the secret agents noted. His correspondence is censored. Letters and litanies are withheld, including his correspondence with Father Cleope Elie. There are various inciting agents, and his apartment is often searched in his absence. In Bucharest, Father Arsenie paints, with Vasile Rudeanu, the altar of the Saint Eleftherie Church. In order to work quietly and avoid secret agents' provocations, he wears a label saying, "I do not answer questions." Several years ago, theology student Alexandru Valentin Crăciun noticed that baby Jesus was wearing prison clothes. Christ the Redeemer has joined the inmates of the communist prisons. It is amazing that for nearly 50 years, no one had noticed. Not one of his informants noticed this detail, which would have triggered dire consequences. Archbishop Justinian Marina is impressed with him, and Father Arsenie is hired in the workshop of the Archbishop at the Bucharest Nuns Convent.
Și acolo făcea medalioane,
He made medallions and various beautiful objects. I went to him and said, Father, I see now you're working in the workshop. Can you paint that painting for me? He painted it the way he saw it through the window in Sâmbătă. The portrait of our Savior, incredibly beautiful. He wrapped it for the motorcycle trip. He told me, this will get you into trouble when you go out of town. The police asked me, what's sticking out there? You're outside. It's a painting, I said. Why is it so big? It just grew big. But it's no bigger than the motorcycle handlebars. The handlebars are pretty wide. It was a big motorcycle, so I got out of trouble. What can you do? On the way back home, something else happened. Around Predial, there was heavy rain. But what do you know? It rained to the left, it rained to the right. But our road was dry. My sister says, what's this? She died, my sister. But back then, she says, what's this? The road is dry. But it was raining left and right. That was the painting's first miracle.
I was going on a trip to Father Arsenie's cell at Sâmbătă, and I had an unexpected encounter. Several believers were carrying a cross because an icon of Father Arsenie had been found. This is what happened.
Someone says, Father, I'm coming from Father Arsenie. Oh dear, has Father Arsenie died? No, no, I've been entrusted by him with a very important mission. Oh dear, I say. What has he done now? She says, I had a vision. She told me about her life and her son, how Father Arsenie had rescued him. He was a mountain climber and got lost in the mountains, fell into a precipice, and no one could find him. They'd been looking for 7 days. Then Father Arsenie prayed so hard that he had a vision and said, you'll find him in that valley. But prepare for burial already. And she said, for that you need to go to the church in Chichis and find an icon I painted and frame it and set it nicely. How am I to do that? I'm poor. There are many foreigners here. My parish is not rich. I don't know about the frame. What if I do something wrong? Now I got frightened too. She says, Father, you're faithful guiding, and I know you'll do it right. Then I prayed to the Mother of God, Mother of God, your will be done. Just don't let me and my family get hurt. I said, look, I don't have enough money for this painting. The icon is pretty big. The woman said, the money for the icon's frame is also on behalf of the Father. He told me to pay for the icon. You only need to do that. So a pilgrimage started then, from Bucharest and Tragoviște. The first ones came from Bucharest. They all said, we want to see the icon. Oh dear, now what? I tell you, there were countless miracles there. Everything was done out of nothing. Every person who came was like a gift from God or the Virgin Mary. They said, Father, I want to give these carpets to the monastery. Okay, do it. Father, I want to donate this crystal chandelier. Great, sister. Father, I want to give away some clothes. By all means, sister. Father, I want to do this. Do it, sister. Don't you say no to anything? No, sister. Why? If the Mother of God sent you here, who am I to disrespect that? So all this church has been built only with gifts sent our way by the Mother of God, so to speak.
Many other icons are spread around the country, like Virgin Mary's Ascension at Brincovano Monastery, painted by Father Arsenije when he was abbey there. Or this icon, given to the Bika family when he left Sambata. The icon of Saint Paraskeva at the Saint Antonia Church in Bucharest. Or the Healing Spring icon at the Trinity Church in Gikate. As well as icons on the chancel screens in Dragonescu and Prislop, about which Father Arsenije said to a nun in Jurez, "These icons will be miracle makers, but only in later days." The most important work was the painting of the church in Dragonescu, 25 kilometers outside of Bucharest, which took Father Arsenije 15 years to make, although a church is normally finished in 2 to 3 years. The new painting and soft nuances of tempera, irradiating the light of the heavenly kingdom. The news spreads that Father Arsenije is at Dragonescu, and dozens of believers come to his church every day. Simple people come to him, as if to a healing saint, for advice on the hardships of life. "People only need to meet me twice," Father Arsenije says. The first time is when the Father tells them what to do. The second time is when they're dying and they say whether or not they did it. Father Arsenije transposes his sermons from Sambata and Prislop into a catechism with personal touches, a warning painting with prophetic imagery, a call to repentance to everyone's understanding. Young theologians come for advice and guidance. Many of them will become priests, abbots, monks, high officials of the Orthodox Church.
Unii au comentat că a făcut o imixtiune în Erminia Bizantină, dar e vorba de o completare care e vizionară, o completare teologică deosebită, în care părintele și-a exprimat
commented on a strange mix.
Toate darurile pe care
yet this is a visionary work. A theological commentary, where Father Arsenije poured his gifts given by God to him, his charisma, an imagery of visions of the mind, only read about or felt in the mind.
I can almost see him now, up high in a wing of the church. He turned around when he heard the door, since the church was empty. What? Did you just want to see me? Well, look at me. Now look at me. I looked for you, Father, and I didn't find you. Well, you found me now.
The year 1968 came as a watershed moment for the country, for the people. Father Savian, at the parish house, went to the church to ask him over for dinner, and he found Father Arsenie on his knees next to the table in the altar, praying to God in a pool of tears. He dared and asked Father Arsenie, "What are you doing, Father?" He answered, "Our country is going through a difficult time, and we need to pray for its healing and the healing of our people." I think it was also because of his prayers that God avoided the tragedy that might have happened here too, as it happened that August in Prague.
Și la noi, precum s-a întâmplat în acel an și în acea lună august la Praga.
Era urmărit, veneau credincioși și...
He was under surveillance, and believers came and stayed secretly at Dragănescu. I participated in a few of his extraordinary meetings. He never tried to impress anyone with anything he had or was.
Niciodată n-a încercat să arate că are ceva care...
And he was not too strict in his understanding of religion. He never forgave anyone any sins they committed. He never said they weren't a sin. But he gave such love to the people who came asking for help that he righted everyone who was in the wrong. I remember I went to church and there were a lot of people inside. Each one was trying to talk to him. The parish priest was there, Savian. He saw there were too many people for Father Arsenie to talk to all of them for as long as they all wanted. So he had a stopwatch at the entrance and said, "You can't talk to him for more than 3 minutes." So I said, "I'll go ask this. I'm 26. What should I do? Take a wife or become a monk?" So he looks at the watch and he says, 15 seconds. That's okay. It gives him 2.5 minutes to talk. So I go to talk to Father Arsenie. My turn came and he said, "What do you want, man? I'm 26. I don't know what to do. Should I take a wife or become a monk?" "Okay," I'm thinking, "now I'll wait." He looks at me and says, "You're no good for either of them. Next." And that was the whole discussion. I had taken a day off, traveled all night by train to Bucharest, from Sibiu to Bucharest, plus time crammed in that church, plus all the way back. Back then, I didn't understand his meaning. It only dawned on me later that no one else could make a decision for me but yourself.
In 1969, Father Arsenie, the nun Zamfira, and a few other former nuns from Prislop buy a house in Sinaia and set up a quasi-monastic settlement. Father Arsenie has a room there, as well as a small painting workshop. In 1976, Prislop Monastery opens again under the Abbess Apollinaria. Such an event, in those times, seems a miracle as only Father Arsenie could make.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
Every now and then he visits Prislop, a place dear to his heart, under the supervision of Father Arsenie. The nuns rebuild and repaint Silvas Abbey. Next to the old church, the Athenite belfry and the Dacian winter tent. New buildings rise. The park is redone. Flowers, magnolias and silver spruce are planted. The older nuns still remember many redeeming or prophetic words spoken by him within the monastic walls. In summertime, Father Arsenie used to spend time alone. A few weeks at Lake Bucura at the Retezat Mountains. He is nostalgic for his childhood summers on the hills of Bujwara. He loves nature and misses solitude. People say he could talk to bears and wolves and deer and the birds in the sky, which all listened to him. The last years of his life are spent secluded at the Sinaya settlement, together with the former nuns of Prislop. He takes short walks in the neighborhood and goes to Bucharest once a month to pick up his meager pension. His health declines. He has heart problems, and in February 1988, his face and left leg are left paralyzed. Strangely, the Secret Service still keeps him under surveillance, though he is now struggling between life and death. It is only on the 7th of October, 1989, that he is withdrawn from the surveillance lists, and the Secret Services acknowledge what they had refused to believe for four decades. Father Arsenie is not conducting hostile activities towards our social state. After his first arrest came the signs of God's wrath. The hand of the investigator who hit him is said to have gone bad, and the man remained a cripple for life. Another miracle was written down in the Secret Service files, no less. Father Arsenie was said to have attended his mother's funeral in a village in the Zarand area, though he was at the time an inmate at the Danube Black Sea Canal. We have found no proof of this, yet people are convinced it happened. Testimonies pile up. They attest each other. It is hard to see where reality ends and the legend begins. Most of these testimonies are anonymous, since Father Arsenie was very discreet in his relations between confessor and confessee.
I saw Father Arsenie in church in the Alba Iulia Cathedral, and seconds later he disappeared. 3 days later, on the Whit Sunday, I went to Sinaia and asked him if he had been in the Alba Iulia. And he said yes, he had been there. During prayer, he said, he felt lifted and felt he was levitating in the Alba Iulia Cathedral. So, Father Arsenie, yes, I felt him to be the receptacle of special gifts. Yet he never showed these gifts off. He didn't show off or brag, he wasn't like that. I always thought his attitude was altogether normal.
Ci attitudinea dânsului, așa mi s-a părut întotdeauna, a fost o atitudine absolut normală.
I had a heart attack. I knew he had said, if we listened to him, he would help us, both here and in eternal life. So after the heart attack in the municipal hospital, they connected me to a machine. Quickly, she's going into a coma. They said that to my daughter and son-in-law. And while I was connected, I started to call out to Father Arsenie. I called out to him in my head. I couldn't speak. I said, Father Arsenie, help me. I didn't open my mouth. I just thought it. 3.5 hours between life and death. My children paid money left and right, but no one paid any attention, not knowing if I was going to make it or not. I felt a hand on my face. It came like this. It stroked my cheek. I opened my eyes right away. But I saw no hand. I didn't see it. I opened my eyes thinking it's my daughter and her husband, knowing they had come along. It wasn't them. They weren't there. It was just the doctor, the professor, and some nurses. So I said, Doctor, I can speak now. I can see that, he says. Thank you for bringing me back to life. Don't thank me. Thank God above. You had someone watching over you up there. I didn't think you'd come back to life.
Celui de sus, Mata, a avut o mână protectoare care te-a ajutat. Eu nu gândeam că Mata mai zice revii la viață.
A man and a priest so gifted by God for 30 years, until he passed away, was forbidden from wearing the priestly cloth or celebrating Mass. That was the greatest hurt in Arsenie Boca's life. He took part in the Mass, but did not celebrate it at the altar. He remained a tower of faith, though he was no longer allowed to receive confessions.
Once in Siania, I asked him, so no one can see you now, why can't you celebrate the Mass here with the right priestly clothes? You're legit and you can celebrate Mass. He said, I can't disobey. I am a monk and I know how to obey. I can't toy around with obedience.
On the 29th of November, 1989, in Sinaia, the earthly body of Arsenie Boca is shed from his spirit. On December the 4th, his body, dressed in a priest's cloak, which he hadn't worn in 30 years, is buried at Prislop Monastery, the resting place of his choosing. His funeral brought together the nuns from Prislop, his closest disciples, and the believers. 1 month later, communism falls in Romania and ends in a bloodbath. While the Ceaușescus are swiftly tried and executed in Târgoviște, for the former communist activists, the secret police, the new democracy is quite promising. For regular people, the more things change, the more they stay the same. As Father Arsenie himself had prophesied, his grave had become a pilgrimage site. At the end of every November, on the day of his death, when the weather suddenly becomes mild, endless lines of flower-bearing pilgrims come to Prislop to share their troubles and gain atonement, to confess their sins and gain absolution. People do not believe that Father Arsenie had died. He is there among them. They feel him like a breeze. Ask him questions in their mind, and receive his guidance also in their mind. They touch his cross and start weeping. Drenched in happiness and spiritual serenity, mediated by Father Arsenije, he is and will remain a saint in the souls of thousands of followers, blessed by his love, a love larger than life.
I read a lot of books when I was a teenager, but none of them fully answered my question. They all sunk me deeper in my rebellion against a God which I found to be harsh, authoritarian, uncaring to man. Or at least, that's how books showed me, as well as my life experience. In high school, this feeling intensified. I started reading Cioran, Camus, Nietzsche, all these rebels against God, who increasingly identified with the God I was carrying in my heart, with all the questions I carried not in my heart, but in my mind. All the questions that I had been unable to answer, they all seemed to find answers in Sartre, and in Cioran, and in Camus. All these prophets of suicide. I was a sophomore in the philosophy department, and I thought of leaving this world that had no meaning except endless pain. There was my philosophy. The further you get, the more you realize life is not worth living, and the faster you arrive at suicide, the better. My brother saw the state I was in, and he'd call me and say, "Man, when will you turn to God?" "Turn where? What God?" The God that you've convinced yourself to believe in. Many times, not God, but the way you believe in him. Your faith is pure self-suggestion. The turning point was this. "Look," he says, "if you think you're so good that you hold the truth and everyone else lives a lie, come to Prislop on the 8th of May. There's a priest there." "What priest?" I say. "You believe in these priests, these people." But I thought I should go, just to show him there was nothing. I took a close friend, whom I think I had influenced, into becoming just as dark and negative, and we went to prison. The courtyard was full of people going to the monastery. My friend and I, we didn't know where to go. We were supposed to enter the church or what? I saw people going higher up. We didn't know where. "Okay," he said, "let's see where they're going." We sat in the shadow there, both under a birch tree, on top of Father Arsenije's grave now. There were no fir trees there then, nor nothing. A group of people were doing something, I didn't know what. I forgot to say that I hadn't cried in years. I thought God was ruthless, and he had thrown us to a merciless world with no kindness. A God who claimed to be good and expected to be praised. In front of such a God, I thought to cry and complain about your needs seemed to me the ultimate humiliation, and I was unwilling to submit to it. And suddenly, I remember, it was 9 or so in the morning, and my tears started to fall. I don't know why. It was like my heart was stormed, my frozen, stone-like heart. I stood up and I said, "What's wrong with me? How can I be crying?" I looked at Palimano, that was my friend. I said, "So you're crying too?" He was crying. And I said, "What's wrong with you?" Something was happening with the both of them. God made it happen. I don't think it was self-suggestion. He had graduated from 3 universities. He was a smart man. So I said, "Are you crying, man? Why are you crying?" I scolded him, like I was any better. I stood up, and I remember even now. For years I had accumulated evil thought against God against my brethren, people I spoke and thought ill of, these thoughts in my mind, as if raining incessantly over me, these thoughts I could never stop. It was as if there was suddenly an umbrella above, like the sky had suddenly cleared, and there came a silence that I will never forget. I think it came from the prayers and the mercy of Father Arsenie, who I didn't even know was there. We were given a little bit of God's grace. I started crying. I think I couldn't stop for days. I had met the God I did not know. And I did not know that God. Who is that God who can remember no evil, nothing bad that I've done, and who has taken me as his own? I couldn't understand. I knew what I had done. I knew I had been evil. I knew how bad I had thought of the Mother of God in my head so many times. And he just received me. I see so many young people in just as much trouble. So bitter and mean. So you think, if I don't speak up about God's miracles, what's left to think for those who felt none or felt too little? God had no reason, no good deed to recommend me to him. He accepted me nevertheless. So I have to testify for him, but also about Arsenie Boca, who is a man of God.
Omul lui Dumnezeu este.